Good evening to all of you. Greetings to you in the most loving and blessed name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This evening, the concept or the title what we are going to learn is the concept of regeneration, which is spoken about in the Bible. The Word of God very spectacularly says us that for all have sinned and come short of the glory of the Lord, in Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Also along with that verse in Psalm number 51, verse number 5, King David says in his confession that, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." These all verses are very specifically tells us that we are born in sins and we are sinners before the Almighty God. Therefore, the concept of regeneration is necessary for all human beings who are living in the world. First of all, that we are going to look into that who needs to be born again. In John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 3, our Lord Jesus Christ, in his discourse with Nicodemus, who came to meet him by night, Jesus said to him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, that except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Also in John, chapter 3, verse 7, repeatedly our Lord Jesus Christ said to him, that you must be born again. There are no excuses to this rule outside of the Savior, neither sex, age, position or condition, caste, color or religion. Bible says that every man needed the concept of getting born again because man is born in sins and trespasses. In Galatians chapter 6, verse 15, Apostle Paul says, "For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but a new creature." That is, getting born again or getting regenerated is giving us the idea that we become a new creature. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, Apostle Paul tells us that if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creation, for all things have passed away and all things become new. When a person believes in the Lord Jesus Christ personally, that God creates a new heart in him. In Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 23, Prophet Jeremiah is asking a paramount important question to the readers of his prophecy. He is asking, "Can an Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard his spot? Then may he also do good that are accustomed to do evil. It is impossible without a rebirth." That means an Ethiopian can never change his color, neither the leopard his spots. Therefore, the prophet was asking the readers of his prophecy or the hearers of his prophecy, that how can you people who are accustomed to do evil can do good in your life? No, man is basically in a very declined state and he cannot save himself. Also in Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, the prophet is continuously speaking about the heart of a man. He says that the heart is deceitful above all other things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Only God can know and deeply know the condition of the heart of a man. Therefore, the necessity of regeneration is a universal aspect. Every man and woman who are living under heaven on the world are necessary to be born again, trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ to have a new nature and to have a new heart. The Bible tells us very specifically the nature of regeneration. What is the nature of regeneration? And first of all, when I explained that concept in view of the biblical evidences, I would like to say that it is not baptism. Many people falsely, they are with the impression that baptism saves the soul and baptism saves the sinner. Bible never tells us so. Baptism is a church ordinance. Our Lord Jesus Christ, after his resurrection, that we know from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, verse 19 and 20, that he came to his disciples and said to him, "All power is given to me from heaven, heaven and on the earth, that you go into the end of the world, preaching them the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe whatsoever the things I have commanded you. Lo, I will be with you always, even unto the end of the age." This is the last command when the Lord Jesus Christ gave his disciples prior to his ascension to heaven. We know that Christian baptism is a Christian ordinance which the Lord has assigned his disciples for their obedience. Christian church has two different ordinances which are assigned to the church. The first one is baptism and the other one is Lord's table. Therefore, baptism is not necessarily assigned to wash out the sins of man, because Bible says that baptism cannot save a man, neither it can wash away the sin of the people. It is not a reformation. Regeneration is not baptism. Regeneration is neither the reformation. Reformation is the act of the old nature turning from certain evils, while regeneration is the supernatural act of God by which the Lord is acting within the heart of a sinner. And regeneration is a spiritual quickening. In Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1 and 2 we read that Apostle Paul says there that we were dead in trespasses and sins. We all who were dead in trespasses and sins, the Spirit of God has quickened us. And therefore, regeneration is a spiritual quickening, a new birth, a new creation. And from creation, everything has brought forth after his kind. Sinners beget sinners. That is the reason that David says in Psalm number 51, verse 5, "Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me." Every man, every woman, every child which is born to this world is born sinners. That is, sin is the intrinsic nature of every man born to this world. And it is not something that has been cultivated after one is born, but it is with which that particular character, man and woman, are born to this world. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17, which I have already quoted before, Paul says that, "Behold, if any man be in Christ Jesus, a new creation, because all things are passed away, and behold, all things are become new." And here, God is giving by rebirth or regeneration a new heart, a new attitude, a new mind, and a new character to the sinner's mind, so that he is entirely changed into a new person, a new being. And the old one is already gone. It is a new one. And then what are the agents which help us in the act of new birth? There are at least two agents which is discussed in the Bible. I would just refer it. First of all, the first agent which enables a sinner to get born again is the Word of God. James chapter 1 verse 18, Apostle James says, James says in his epistle, "Of his own will begat he us with the word of the truth." Of his own will that he begat us with the word of his truth. And also in 1 Peter 2 verse 3, Peter says, "Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which lives and abideth forever." So, he that is born of the Spirit, or the one who is getting born again, or in the other word, I would say the one who is getting saved or regenerated, is regenerated or born again, not by the corruptible word, but by the incorruptible word, which is the word of God. So one reason that so few people are born again today through modern preaching is that there is not enough the word of God that they are presenting through their preaching. Galatians chapter 3 verse 2, received this ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of the faith. It is by faith that you and I are regenerated by the grace of God. So the first agent which helps a sinner in believing the Lord Jesus Christ or to trust him that he should be born again is the incorruptible word of God. And secondly, it is the Spirit of God. Spirit of God is the second agent which helps a sinner getting regenerated. John chapter 3 verse 5, Jesus said, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter in the kingdom of God. A great confusion has brought about in interpreting these particular words which I have recited now. Jesus said that you must be born by water and born by Spirit. What does it mean? Some people, fortunately, they interpret that the water Jesus referred is water baptism. Therefore, some Pentecostal people are falsely teaching that it is not the saving faith in Jesus Christ alone would suffice to save a sinner. Rather, they say that a baptism is also necessary, or baptism completes the salvation act they teach. It is absolutely wrong when we learn the salvation concept strictly, which is governed in the Word of God. What the Word of God says is that you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. There are certain instances which are recorded in the book of Acts, which gives us the first 37 years of the history of the Christian church. In Acts chapter 2, in the day of Pentecost, when Peter stood up along with the other 11, and he profoundly preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. In that long sermon that Peter delivered in the day of Pentecost, that he emphasized three important points. That is, that three things that God had done toward the children of Israel. And number two, three things that the Israelites had done unto the Lord Jesus Christ. And thirdly, now three things that the children of Israel have to do with the Lord Jesus Christ. And he summarized his message in systematizing his points like this, that he said three things that the Almighty God had done in the history. That God sent his only begotten Son to be the Savior of this world. That is what we read in John's Gospel chapter 3 verse 16, that for God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. God sent his only begotten Son to this world to become the Savior of this world. And secondly, God raised him from the dead. He raised him up from the dead. That was the wondrous works that God the Father has done toward the Lord Jesus Christ, that he sent him first to the world and then he raised him from the dead. And thirdly, we read that he exalted his name above all the names in heaven and the earth and in the Hades. That means the highest name, highest position, Jesus Christ was lifted up by the Almighty God. And now, three things that these people had done unto the Lord Jesus Christ. They have been resisting and rejecting the Savior. They have been resisting and rejecting the Savior. Number two, that they have handed him into crucifixion in the hands of his enemies. And thirdly, they crucified him. Now Peter was exhorting them that each of you must repent of your sins, that you have given up the Lord Jesus Christ in the hands of his enemies, that he should be crucified. You have to repent of your sins, and then you have to accept the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart as your own personal Savior and Lord, so that your sins will be forgiven. And thirdly, he commanded them that each of you, having accepted the Lord Jesus Christ to your heart, you have to obey him in what is of baptism. What we read in Acts chapter 2 verse 41 and 42, that those who were accepted his word were baptized, and 3,000 were added to them in that day. When we come to the fourth chapter of the book of Acts, we read that the people who believed in Jesus Christ, even the men, their number were increased to 5,000. People were kept on believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. So The Spirit of God was the agent which helped the sinners to be convinced on the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. John chapter 3 verse 5, the Lord Jesus Christ emphasized there, you except ye be born of water and of the Spirit, that you shall not enter in the kingdom of God. What Jesus was saying, the word here pictured, the water here pictured the word of God, that you should be born again by the incorruptible word of God. And secondly, you must be born again by the help of the Holy Spirit of God. And again, John 3:6, we read, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. So Jesus said, you must be born by the Spirit. You must be born again by the Spirit. You and I were born to this world in this fleshly nature, that this flesh is succumbable to death. Bible is very clearly tells us so. So that which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. That which is born of the flesh cannot enter into the kingdom of God, because that sphere is entirely different from the sphere where we are living now on the earth. Unless we put on that heavenly nature by means of rebirth, that means by means of regeneration, one cannot enter into the kingdom of God. So in John 3:8, the Lord again said, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is first to convict the sinner and then to convert him, to do the actual work of bringing him to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. What did our Lord Jesus Christ say? What act would the Spirit of God would do when he comes to dwell with men forever? Jesus said that he will convince the world of sin, and he also will exhort the people of the righteousness of God, and then he will also explain to them the truth that the Lord Jesus Christ has taught them. These are the threefold ministries which were spoken about the Holy Spirit was doing when he had descended to this world. And in the day of Pentecost, since the day that of Pentecost, the Spirit of God had come down personally here to dwell in the church, for all the past 2000 years, wherever the gospel was presented, it was the Holy Spirit of God who was convincing the heart of the sinner and enabling him to look upon the cross of Jesus Christ to be convinced of his crucifixion. Enabling him to believe that it was for his sake that Jesus died on the cross. When the Spirit of God speaks to us, and when a person, when a sinner is yielding his life to the counsels or the exhortation of the Spirit of God, that sinner is born again, or he is regenerated by the help of the Holy Spirit of God. And fourthly, I'll have to say again, the method of regeneration. The method of regeneration, what the Bible tells us about. And there are two methods which is governed in this regard. Number one, the divine side. What does the Lord do in relation to saving a soul through the regeneration? In John chapter 1 verse 13, and here Apostle John says that which were born, that means he that is born, they that are born of the Spirit, or they that are getting regenerated, or they that are getting saved, they were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, and nor of the will of man, but of God. That is the peculiarity of the new birth, that you and I were born after the flesh, after the will of man, after the desire of man, and after the relationship of the blood of man. But that which is born of the Spirit is born free from the flesh, free from blood, free from human desires, and free from human will. We were begotten by the will of God. James 1:18. Quoted in, again, I have already told it in the above notification, that we are saved, or we are born again by the incorruptible word, which is the word of God. That is the divine side, because God is saving us free of human will, free of human blood, free of human flesh. And now it is absolutely, or basically, or fundamentally, it is by the help of the Holy Spirit. And secondly, the human side also we have to be understood. In John's Gospel chapter 1 verse 12, Apostle Paul, John sequentially says it there, that but as many as have received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believes in his name. That means here John was telling the human part is to believe, the divine part is to regenerate. When a person believes in the Lord Jesus Christ and believes in the substitutionary death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary, on the basis of his personal faith in Christ, on account of his conviction of his sins, that the Spirit of God is regenerating him into a new man. It's a very mysterious act which the Holy Spirit of God is doing with the sinful heart of a man. And therefore, we understand in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, 15, Apostle Paul is asking, Paul was asking the Corinthian believers an important question. He says, for in Christ Jesus have I begotten you, through the gospel of Jesus Christ. He said, you will have so many teachers who teach you from the word of God, but I was the person who begotten you by the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a new beginning. It's a new beginning that happens in the life of a sinner, whereas when he repents of his sins and is convinced of his sinful, awful condition, looking upon the cross of Jesus Christ and conceiving the truth that it was for him that he died on the cross of Calvary, the Spirit of God saves him on the basis of his personal faith upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Then we'll have to see one or two things more in this relation. Another thing, the evidence of regeneration. Often people asking the question, how can I know that I am regenerated? Or how can I know that I am saved? I would like to tell you certain points which is given in the Bible. The one who is born again lives a righteous life. Very often when I used to write in the Facebook about the security of salvation, people who do not believe it, they often used to ask me the question, how can you say, Pastor, that the one who is saved yet he is sinning is saved forever? Is it a license that you are giving to the people to continue in sin when you present the doctrine of security of salvation? Dear friends who are hearing me, I tell you solemnly that it is not I who give that guarantee, but Jesus said that he who liveth and believes in me shall never die. And in the last day, I shall raise him up. Not only that, as I pointed out yesterday in one of my messages, Jesus Christ in John's Gospel chapter 10, he ascertained that all who have believed in me, whom I have given to my father, and from whose hand no one can pluck them away. Nobody can pluck them away because they are safely kept in the arms of our Almighty God, who is keeping up unto the day of redemption from falling. So I would specifically say that the one who is born again will have necessarily a righteous life when he lives here on the world. 1 John 2:29 says, if you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. That means a believer in Christ shall live an exemplary righteous life that can be noticed by everyone. Not only his family members, not only his friends, not only his neighbors, everyone who come in touch with him, they will come to know that this man is really saved, really born again. And secondly, the born again one does not live a life of sin. This is the question often people used to ask me. If a person who says that I am born again and I am saved, but yet he is committing sin, then what shall be his destiny? My Bible says, the born again one shall not deliberately commit sin. That is the answer. Apostle John is giving his first epistle. That one which is born again, will not continue in the same sin. I don't deny the possibility of one committing a sin occasionally or accidentally, because we are still living in the human flesh. The Lord Jesus Christ, after saving our soul that we have not left, he has not translated us immediately into heaven. Rather, he has let us live in this flesh so long that we come to the maturity till the Lord Jesus Christ. So we are now left in the world, and we are left in the world, and we are also being helped by the Holy Spirit of God to lead a life that is righteousness. Here, John says that one who really born again, one who is really regenerated, will not live a life of sin. That means he will not indulge himself in a sinful condition for long. And if at all, if anything that untoward may happen to his life, soon after that incident, that he will rise up and will confess his sins to the Lord Jesus Christ, and Christ will cleanse him with his blood and with his word, as he has promised us in 1 John chapter 2 verse 1 and 2. What we read therein, John says that, my little children, that these things I write unto you, that ye might not sin. But if anyone sins, he says that we have an advocate, even our Lord Jesus Christ, at the right hand side of the Father in heaven, with whom we have to do. That he is actually supplicating on our behalf. He is our great high priest. He is asking God the Father on our behalf. And he is providing that forgiveness of sin, provided that we confess our sins to the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, I would say the first evidence that one is born again is that one who is born again lives a righteous life before others. And secondly, he will not indulge himself in a sinful life. And thirdly, the born again individual will fulfill the commands to love one another. What John says again, the one who says that he is born again, or one who says that he loves God yet is not loving his brother, he is not a believer, he says. And the person who has believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and the person who have been converted to Christ, Lord Jesus Christ, will have demonstrating the love of Jesus Christ through his life in front of others. Love is the primary symptom or primary sign that others can see in us that we are born again. And fourthly, the born again individuals lives an overcoming life. 1 John 5:4 says that, for whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. We are living in a sinful world and in the influence of sin. And always in our body we have the constant and continuous fight between the flesh and the spirit. If you want to learn it further or more about that concept, that you'll have to read through Romans chapter 7. Apostle Paul says that in me, that is in my flesh, I see two different laws, the law of sin and the law of God. In same person dwelling two different principles. One is the law of sin and the other one is the law of God. And then he says that I would like to do good, but the evil comes in my life. Where does it come from? Then he was searching for it. He says that even though I desire to do good, yet I am doing evil. It is not me, but the law of sin which is dwelling in me is making me to do that evil. And in 7th chapter 20, verse 24, he was alarming, or he was saying, oh, what an arrogant man am I, who shall deliver me from this body which is bondage to death? Who shall deliver me this body from bondage to death? And he is also giving thanks to the Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to the Lord Jesus Christ, who always triumphs us through our life. So Jesus Christ helps us to triumph us in this worldly Christian life. And he says the one who is born again really, that he overcomes the world. When temptations to commit sin is inviting you and me, that to be tempted unto sin, that we are receiving the grace of God and we are trusting the Holy Spirit of God and seeks his protection and his counsel, and yielding our flesh, our body, our soul to the counsel of the Holy Spirit of God. And that way, that we are overcoming all the situation. And finally, those who are born again and one believes that Jesus is the Christ. 1 John chapter 5 verse 1, he says, whosoever believeth that Jesus Christ is born of God the Father. And the opposite of that verse is that the one who does not believe that Jesus Christ is God, he is not born of God the Father. We have believed the Lord Jesus Christ is our Savior and he is the God manifest in the flesh. And I would conclude this lesson here also telling you the result of regeneration. See, what is the result? What is the symptomatic result of regeneration? I would like to say that the heart which is changed, we have a changed heart. Sin is hated. That means a person who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ have already got a changed heart. So he in his further life, that means in his day-to-day life, that he is hating sin. And moreover, that Christ is loved in his day-to-day life. The life is changed. His life and life character is changed. New and holy desires springing up like a well of living water from his bowels. John chapter 4 verse 14. Jesus said that he that believeth in me, out of his belly or bowels shall spring out the rivers of living water. So the one who has really born again, he will have a changed heart, a changed attitude, a changed habit, and a changed nature. Not only that, the rivers of living water shall spring up from his bowel, that means from his heart. His mouth speaks out what was filled in his heart within. And also, John chapter 7 verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his inmost being shall flow rivers of living water. So one who is born again is actually born for the second time. It is not a natural birth. It is not a birth by the blood. It is not a birth by the human will. Or it is not the result of a human desire. But it is not the birth from the flesh. It is by the Spirit of God that you and I are born again. Once you are born again, Bible says, you are born again for eternity. That is what some people defeats when I speak it here. Bible says that once you are delivered from the bondage of sin, once you are delivered from the punishment, terrible punishment of sin, that you are saved and saved for good. What we read in Romans chapter 8 verse 1, now there is therefore no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. The moment that you and I believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, we were placed in Christ. Since then, we are safe in Christ. Even Satan cannot accuse us because our names are written down in the book of life. We are placed in the everlasting hands of the Almighty God. We are mostly secured there. No man can pluck us away from his hand because he is the most powerful and eternal God. This is what the Bible teaches us, the concept of getting born again or the concept of regeneration. It is absolutely and fundamentally by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. As Martin Luther, the great reformer of the 17th century, has stated, let me say that salvation or regeneration is only by faith in Jesus Christ, only through the blood of Jesus Christ, and only through the person of Jesus Christ. That means by Christ alone, by blood alone, and through grace alone, which was revealed through Christ Jesus. Let us be thankful to God for the grace which has brought us home and which has regenerated us in the family of God. Whereas, as we read in John's Gospel chapter 1 verse 12, for as many as have received them, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believes in his name. Dear friends who are listening to me all around, may I tell you that you do not need to expense anything from your side that you should be saved tonight. Simply trust him. All what was necessary for redeeming you from the clutches of sin, Christ has paid it for all on the cross by giving up his body as a perfect sacrifice on the cross. Now you come to the Lord Jesus Christ by the help of the Holy Spirit and confess your sin to the Lord, saying, Lord, I believe that you died in my stead on the cross of Calvary and you shed your blood for my salvation. I believe that you died for me, you were buried for me, and on the third day you resurrected out of the grave for my salvation. Now come to my heart and save my soul if you offer this prayer humbly to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord is willing to save you. What do we read in Revelation chapter 3 verse 20? Where the Lord Jesus Christ says to the church at Laodicea that, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man come and open the door, I will come in him. Come with him. I will come in and have sup with him, he with me. That the Lord is desiring to have a fellowship with us. Would you offer your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? And the believers who are hearing me from all around, let us be thankful to God for the great salvation which God has given us and which now we enjoy in our life, in our heart, by means of regeneration which the Spirit of God has resulted in our life. Thank you for listening to me. May God bless you all. Thank you.